I'm Mary Polchaninoff, and welcome to Sure Things. Today we're going to do a follow-up. I interviewed Chris Pallatto, Executive Director of the YMCA here in Westbrook, about a year ago. About a year ago. So we want to welcome Chris back. Welcome, Chris.
Thank you.
Wow, what a difference a year makes.
Well, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So I remember when we, last year when we were talking, and we had met also about changes at the Y coming up and plans for expansion, all of these wonderful ideas, and then we had the pandemic and everything got shut down. So what's been going on during the pandemic? How is that growth going at the Y?
So for us, like a lot of other folks, it's been a long, interesting year,
yeah,
and lots of changes and lots of iterations of what we do normally. And so I'll just talk a little bit about what we've done operationally,
yeah,
and then we'll kind of get into what's the future. But
yeah,
the first thing we really needed to do after we closed in March was be prepared to open in June. And so that required really redesigning our entire business. And so if we were to open up a brand new Y tomorrow, we all know what to do and walk in during normal times. But with all the regulations and the safety requirements and the social distancing and the way we operate and the way we run programs, so we really had to spend the moment we closed in March until we opened in June to kind of reinvent the way we operate.
You really did. So that actually meant inside perhaps changing some of the flow or the programs?
Yes.
Oh, I didn't realize that. Okay.
Yeah, so everything from the moment you walk in, you know you're in a safe environment.
Yeah.
So we have, you know, like a lot of other folks, we have the way we designed our desks to have the plexiglass,
mm-hmm,
so that people are, you know, behind a barrier and extra hand washing stations,
yeah,
and taking temperatures and traffic flow and which treadmills to have and what equipment to offer and what amenities we can open.
Yeah.
And so I'm very proud of our staff and our team for the work they did to get us open. And,
yeah,
and I would say that overwhelmingly the feedback has been very positive, and people feel very safe at the Y.
Mm-hmm.
We've done surveys and checked in with our members, but it really couldn't have gone any better. So when people say, how are things going at the Y? I always say they're going very smoothly, but slowly.
Yeah.
And as people are getting vaccinated, we're seeing people return, but it's still, you know, we're still less than half of capacity where we were last year. It's increasing every month, but it's still slower than we've been used to.
Do you still have people registering? You still have to register to get in, right? To do,
yes,
a class,
yep,
or to get into that area. And do you, looking ahead, do you foresee that that's going to continue through the summer, that people should go before they go to the Y, they should go on and register?
Yes. Yeah, so one of the most important things has been making sure that we're staying within our capacities for the building. So
yeah,
this reservation system is for everything, whether you want to use the cardio room or the weight room or the pool. And so when all the restrictions are off, we will probably get rid of the reservation system for our cardio and wellness center,
because,
yeah, people like to be able to just come in and go work out.
Yeah.
But we are going to survey our members and talk a little bit more, because one of the things we didn't expect is a lot of our swimmers really like making a reservation. So
really?
Swimmers prefer, of course, having their own lane, but
yeah,
sharing a lane is the second choice, and no one really likes to circle swim with three or more swimmers. And so being able to make a reservation as a lap swimmer, you know when you can start, you know you'll have,
wow,
no more than one person in your lane. And so a lot of our swimmers have said, we hope you keep it. So we're going to do a little more research into that. We're also probably going to use it for some of our busier group exercise classes. There's nothing worse than you get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, you head down to the Y, and your favorite spin class is filled, and then you're frustrated. And so we'll probably use it for that,
yeah,
and rack a ball, but for the casual member who just wants to come in and lift weights, that's probably going to go away first.
So that actually ended up being a good thing. You,
yeah,
you found that that's something that you could actually use.
Yeah.
And I know that I had the ladies on. We did actually a show where we had some exercises that you could do at home. So I know there was a lot more that was online if you wanted to join classes too during the pandemic. That,
yes,
was new, right? That was new for the pandemic.
Correct.
Yeah. And were you able to get any feedback on how that was going with the members?
Yeah, so I think overwhelmingly the feedback about the online classes has been very positive,
yeah,
particularly when we closed and everyone was shut down. You know, if you remember going to the grocery store and it was very eerie because there's no one on the
scary
roads, and
yeah,
when everyone was locked in, we offered all of our classes online for free to the community,
yeah,
and that was really, really well received. And since then, we've added more classes. We've, you know, purchased a software that allows us to upload our classes,
yeah,
and stream them. But moving forward, we've come to realize that virtual classes are going to be part of people's wellness experience moving forward, whether it's the Peloton app or the new Apple app or the Wise new platform. But people want to have some flexibility in their schedule. And so being able to do exercises from home is going to be really important for them.
Right. So you've been operating at reduced capacity.
Yes.
And you just wait for, I guess, the guidelines, obviously, to come out where you can open up fully, more fully. And then you would be letting people know about those classes and everything, because as it is now, as you said, you have to make that reservation or register to make sure you get in that class.
Correct.
As it is now. We also talked a year ago about some of the expansion ideas we had that you had. That it was a major, major work. What's been going on with that? Is there any movement towards renovation?
Yes. Yeah, so two things are happening in tandem. The first is when we closed, everything stopped. Yeah. Everything stopped. It took all of our effort to reopen and keep our focus on providing safe and quality experiences to people that are coming. Yeah. And so a lot of the extra things that we were doing in the community, including fundraising, had really needed to stop. We just didn't have the staff bandwidth to do a lot in the past year on a capital development side. But we're beginning those efforts again. And what we've decided to do is start our construction process in phases. And so right now at the Y, they're replacing the roof on what will become our new fitness center. And which is exciting. The staff and the members are thrilled to hear hammers in the air.
I bet.
Our first goal is to make sure that the wellness center is ready for January 2022. We don't suspect a lot of people will return to traditional activities until then, for a number of reasons.
That's what you're thinking.
Yeah.
So you're thinking that part will be done when you're looking at the phases of the renovation.
Yep.
Do you have, because I know we talked about this last time when we thought it would be done, do you have an idea of, given the big picture, when you'd like things to be done?
When I'd like to be done?
I know we thought that last time. It was what you'd like to be done, right?
What we do ultimately determines on how much we raise. And so we've raised, we're more than 50% of the way towards our final goal, which is great. But we haven't moved the needle at all in 2020 because of our focus on operations.
Right.
And so while we start this construction process, we'll continue to raise money in the community. And the second thing that we're doing is that we really believe, just like virtual classes will be part of people's experience, we really think that outdoor activities will be part of people's preferences as well. So thanks to a very generous donation from the Westbrook Foundation, we are renovating our outdoor space by the pavilion. So summer camp went really well last year because it was parents want to get their kids outside and engaged. And so the pavilion is going to be used for summer camp, but we're putting a new roof on, redoing the office structure and the siding, so it just looks nice. Updating the landscaping, installing a rock climbing tower, a new basketball court.
Out that way?
So it'd be nice. And then the other part is that we'll be able to do outdoor exercise classes.
I was going to ask you that because I remember I actually did. We actually did a spinning class once, way back. We are able to go outside. So what type of classes do you envision that we could that you could have outside?
We expect to be able to do anything we want out there, really. We can have a second set of weights out there. Yeah. We could do some of like the classes that require weights and bands and bars.
Yeah.
We could also do like yoga classes out there in the spring and the fall when it's not too hot.
Nice.
And it's going to be beautiful when it's done. And again, we're very grateful for the Westbrook Foundation's support of this project because we know that this is going to be important to people. Like, I've come to love eating outdoors. I mean, I hope every restaurant that's put these tables and special areas out keeps them, because that's fantastic.
It is, and
I think people are going to want to exercise outside, have a nice breeze, and be able to kind of interact and be out in nature. So that's an exciting part of our renovation. And that's underway right now, and the majority of it will be done before summer camp. And then the landscaping will be done in the fall. We don't think the landscaping would survive 100 kids a day trampling around. So.
How is that going with your summer camp registration? Does that even open yet?
Yep, summer camp registration for YMCA Camp Shore, which is held at the building, is doing really well. And so actually, we're expecting to have a great summer.
Wow, so that's going full tilt. Now, will you also do swim lessons for kids during the summertime?
Yes. So the governor announced yesterday that there's some changes in the requirements related to capacity, which will help us offer swim lessons.
Right.
One of our challenges has been that we can't offer traditional group lessons because of the social distancing rules.
Yeah.
And so the way our lessons are structured is that, you know, you have a small group of children who sit and kind of get one-on-one instruction with their instructor, and it's safe and they're monitored. But when they have to be 6 feet apart, it's not feasible to be able to do. So we're hopeful that, you know, after May 19th, we'll be able to offer more traditional swim lessons.
That's interesting, because I actually looked for April break, because you had it in the past where you'd actually, was it last year or the year before, we actually had free lessons, remember, for the kids for that week. And so I actually looked for it this year and I didn't see it. So I thought, well, perhaps because of COVID.
Yeah, we've generally done it during the winter break between the last day of school and then January 1st. That's a program that we get funded through the Community Foundation of Middlesex County, and then the Westbrook Foundation has also supported that this year. But because we weren't able to run it, what our plan is to offer Westbrook residents free swim lessons once we're able to offer them, in lieu of doing the bigger traditional program, because the Westbrook Foundation obviously wants to support folks and families that are in Westbrook. But we're very eager to kind of restart all those programs that are so important to us. But that's been part of our challenge, is that every 4 to 6 weeks, some of the rules change. Sometimes they're a little stricter, or a little looser. And our goal is not to interpret or cast judgment on the rules. It's to follow the rules and make sure we're doing exactly what we're supposed to, and that people are safe when they come to the Y. And we know ultimately we will come out of this.
Yeah, we will. We will. I know. It is. It's been a long road, but it has been a little bit more positive with hearing about the things opening up. So that's great to hear, even about the lessons that'll be opening up. And you had childcare there. Mm-hmm. So during COVID, was that also nixed because the kids couldn't be together?
Correct. Right. So we call that program Amazing Kids. It's our Child Watch program for members to drop their kids off.
Yeah.
And when we surveyed our members last, overwhelmingly, people were just a little hesitant to put their kids in an environment with other kids outside the school system. So that's something we think we'll bring back in the fall. I suspect now that it's getting warmer out, people have already developed habits, and they're not likely to return as much as we want everyone to come back right now. We just know realistically that people, have, you know, as they're starting to get vaccinated, everyone's kind of a let's wait and see kind of mode. So they feel better, they're starting to explore things, but I think there are some activities, particularly indoor activities, that people are going to avoid for the next few months. And so we're just trying to be planful.
Oh, great. That's great foresight. Okay. We're going to take a short break, and when we come back, we're going to learn more about the Y and what's coming up. Take care.
I'll be seeing you in all the old familiar places that this heart of mine embraces all day through.
Community TV, your neighborhood TV.
Publicly funded and a reliable partner for cable companies nationwide, it provides transparent coverage of local and state government, education, and public programming.
A digital town green that can be watched anywhere, anytime, and on any device.
Watch us on today's high-tech distribution methods.
Community TV in Connecticut.
Local,
unfiltered,
reliable,
and yours.
Hi, welcome back to Shore Things. I'm here today with Executive Director Chris Pallatto. Welcome back, Chris.
Thank you.
So we've been talking about the pandemic and changes that have been made and looking ahead to how things might start opening up, as gradual as that might be. Yep. I did want to talk a little bit about what just came out, though, that information about the 24/7 platform at the Y. Could you just explain what that is?
Oh, it's great. Yeah. It's one of the benefits of going through this pandemic is it has caused everyone to think about the way they do business and the way they collaborate. And we've been offering a pretty good schedule of online classes since we closed, but there's endless possibilities, particularly with, you know, apps like Peloton and the Apple app and other apps, and that's not something we can keep up as a small community organization. And so we've partnered with YMCAs around the country on this platform called Burn Along, and we are calling it, our local version, Y Wellness 24/7. And so we're going to offer a small offering of classes locally. We're taking you know, some of our more popular classes and offering them on this platform. But then instructors from around the country are also offering 3 to 5 classes a week. So our members will have access to hundreds of classes live every week and thousands of classes on demand.
Wow.
And what's nice is that, you know, we're doing our most popular classes. So yoga and boot camp and some other things that people can do. But this platform, there are 10-minute yoga classes or 30-minute, you know, burpee challenges or fitness workshops or things you could do with your dog or fitness activities for kids. And it's, they're available anytime you want. And so, and for us, you know, we tried to figure out how many people are watching and using and how much are we able to invest. And what we've learned is that this will allow us to, you know, do our very best programming and have access for our members to have hundreds of other opportunities we wouldn't be able to provide. So we're excited about it. We just announced it to our members yesterday, and our instructors will start teaching live in May.
So it's definitely online now?
Yes.
So people can go on and
people can go and test and play around. But the big question our members have is, well, where do I see like Kate or Deanna or my favorite instructors? And we're kind of in the pilot phase right now, so we're making sure we're getting all the kinks out for the technology locally. Yep. But all the other instructors that are on the platform have been doing this for the better part of 6 months, and so people can log on and again, there's already 1,000 classes that people can scroll
through.
That
is awesome. Yeah. You'll be able to get that. The measurement, the data, that shows how many people are tuning in to certain things. Because I wonder about that, if you actually can analyze that as well.
Yes.
Now, do you think for somebody that lives in a different state or whatever, if they wanted to do this, but they're not going to go into the brick and mortar building, is there going to be a separate fee to be able to just do that platform? Or is that a membership still? About the same.
Yeah, right now for us here locally, it's part of your YMCA membership.
Okay.
We may consider a virtual only component in the future, but right now we want to make it as a added benefit for our
part
members.
Part of the benefit, right.
What we've come to realize is that people who like being around other people, which is the big, it's our secret sauce.
Right,
you know what I mean? It's connecting people around healthy activities and building relationships. Mm-hmm. And people who are drawn to that are not going to, you know, forego getting together as a group forever. But they have come to like, just like I like eating outdoors, right? They've come to like being able to do classes early in the morning or late at night. And so this will be a nice supplement for a traditional YMCA membership.
Yeah, I think it sounds wonderful. Yeah. I'm just thinking of all the different groups that might be able to use it, even if they're in a different setting, like a senior center or something, that they could tune in and do some of the workouts, which is great.
Yeah.
One of the other things that is usually popular around this time is your garden.
Yes.
So I wanted to ask about the community garden. What's going on with that?
Yes. So we are having a garden work weekend actually this Saturday. And our goal is to tidy up all the beds and get everything ready for planting, which we usually plant around Memorial Day. But prepping the beds actually takes a fair amount of work. So, you know, we've got a lot of generous garden bed sponsors who have sponsored individual beds. We had a very nice grant from the Order of Malta to help us really do a lot of upgrades to the garden this year.
Wow.
And so we've got, you know, I don't know how many triaxles of topsoil we just had dropped off, but we're going to, you know, set our beds this weekend. And all the produce goes to the local food pantry. All the produce that we produce goes to the Westbrook Food Pantry at St. Mark's. And one of the things that we've done this year as part of our commitment to sustainability is that we've been coordinating volunteers for food delivery, or food distribution rather.
Yes.
And so we did one Farmers to Family program at the Y in December, January, and you know, had 100 or so families come up and tons of volunteers come out, and you know, it was a contactless, take a box of food, put it in your trunk. And then now we're working with the Lions Club in Old Saybrook and at a different location every month. But so many of our YMCA members and families have really stepped up and come out to help, you know, put food in people's cars and make a difference. It's actually been really, really moving to be part of that experience.
It reminds me so much of the food share experience, where they have the drive-through. So this is people actually coming up, not that you're actually physically delivering it to their door, but they're actually driving up and getting the food.
Yep.
And how often would you be doing that, do you know?
We do it the last Thursday of every month.
Oh, you do it the last Thursday.
And I don't recall where it is this month, but
okay, yeah.
But it is. But we're, you know, we recruit our members, and so it's kind of interesting. They show up with a big, giant truck of food from all over, and we have about an hour and a half, 2 hours to decide what we have, divide it evenly into bags, set it up on the tables, and then go. And the nice thing is that no one has ever turned away. There's always enough food to get through the day, or we've been fortunate in that regard so far. And it's just been great. It's just been great to get people and food in the hands of people who need it. And there's a lot of people who've been just impacted that never thought they'd be in this situation. Right. And, you know, we talk with some of our volunteers because they observe, like, oh, boy, some people have some pretty nice cars. And, you know, what we've come to realize is that people who had two-income families and kids in college, both laid off, both without a job, or their jobs were eliminated, or other hardships, or been, you know, illnesses, and now they're struggling. And so this has just been a great way to give people the boost that they need when they need it.
That's wonderful. Yeah. Did you just start that during the pandemic? Is that when that started?
That's when we started participating at the Y. So the Farmers to Families program is a federal program that was new within the past year.
Okay.
And so, like I said, we coordinated one of them through the United Way, and then now we're partnering with the Lions Club, and they've been working with, I think, Food Share and and other organizations. It's been great.
Chris, that's wonderful.
Yeah.
It's just so amazing. We talked about the gems of the shoreline, but it's so amazing that the Y is so community-focused and does so much outreach like that. That's wonderful.
Yeah.
We talked a little bit before we got on about the employment, because I was saying how it's good at the website, and you mentioned that you had to let some people go with the pandemic.
Yes. Yeah, it was. We had to make a lot of very difficult decisions very quickly, quite frankly, because, you know, like a lot of businesses, before the government payroll protection program and the emergency economic injury disaster loans and these other federal products came out, there was a lot of organizations that weren't sure if they were going to be in existence. And so very quickly we made the decision to, you know, to cut 50% of our full-time staff, which is we're very small anyway.
Yes.
And then a lot of our part-timers, of course, so, you know, when we weren't open, you know, we had to let a lot of folks go or reduce our staff. Since we've been open, we've invited all of our part-timers back, but a lot of folks, you know, they have compromised immune systems, or they're older, or they're younger, and their parents don't want them to work. And so a lot of businesses, the Y included right now, are really struggling to find frontline workers.
Really?
Yep. And, you know, I think there's a combination of reasons for that, but I think it'll improve as the summer moves on and people become vaccinated, but it's very difficult, as an example, right now, to find lifeguards. So if there's anyone listening that are lifeguards or have kids that should be lifeguards, come on down.
No, I saw lifeguards advertised, lifeguards on the front of the desk, right?
Yeah.
And I was, as I said, I was surprised when you said you laid people off, because I thought that you'd probably have, you know, more people than you need. But it's just, it sounds like it's just a slow startup, and then that might get better, because those people are so important when you
absolutely they're everything.
In.
And you know, there's really two thresholds. The first threshold is, you know, we're of a shorter than normal operating schedule, and we're operating a lot less programs. Some of our childcare programs aren't running this year.
Right.
And so by the nature of that, we have less staff. But now that we're reopened, it's tough finding people to fill the positions that we have. And again, we're not alone. I shared with you, you know, on the break that we talk with the other Ys around the state, and a lot of our board members operate in their own businesses, and it's something that the whole state is facing. So we're no different. But we're working our way through it like everybody else.
Right. I didn't realize that, though, because like you said, we talked about during the break, I didn't realize even other employers are finding that pinch of trying to get people back on board.
Yep. I think there's a number of things. I think the first is some people are just uncomfortable being indoors, and if it's a part-time job, they may say, look, I don't need the money this year, and a lot of parents are telling their kids they don't want them to work this year. They say, look, just... we'll give you gas money this year, and so we just want you to ride it out. And then, you know, like a lot of other employers, we employ a lot of seniors, and so a lot of folks, they're just concerned about their health overall. And, and again, I do think come September, it's going to be a much different landscape.
It's going to be. You mentioned that you're operating on a reduced capacity, but you still, your hours and everything are still the same, right?
No, we used to traditionally open at 5 o'clock in the morning. Yeah. Now we open 5 a.m. twice a week, and we close at 7 at night throughout the week.
And what was it before?
We used to close at 9 o'clock.
Oh, nine.
Or 9:30 rather.
Yeah.
But what we found is that we're not turning people away.
Right.
This is about the volume that we can handle. They're about the volume that's needed. Our first priority really is to start opening up for the early morning shifts, because those are the folks that need to get to work. And every now they can only come twice a week, and we know that's a hardship for them. And so as soon as we're able, we'll start adding some hours in the morning. And then our second group of, or priority group, would be our families. And right now, because Child Watch is closed and there's not recreational swim, which has been restricted by the rules from the governor, there's a lot of families are just eager to come back and
they're
have things to do
for
their family. So
of course, that Y is always buzzing. Besides the roof and the pavilion that you're going to work on for those areas, is there any other big area that you're looking at with renovation?
Our master plan includes a complete, you know, refresh and an infrastructure redo of the entire building. But our priorities, based on the money we've raised so far, will be the wellness center, which is the was what really keeps the physical plant of the Y open. All of our mission-driven work and our outreach to the community is done through fundraising and any excess from program and membership fees, but generally through fundraising. But if we want to have the lights on in the building, it's through membership. And so this is really a priority. And I'll tell you, that old pool that we're converting to the Wellness Center, it's got these beautiful high ceilings. It's 6,000 square feet. It's going to be amazing.
It's
our goal is the nicest Wellness Center on the shoreline.
And when do you think that might
That'll be ready for January.
That'll be ready for January. That is exciting.
We are thrilled.
And that'll be amazing to watch and see.
Yeah, we can't wait. It's going to be great. And, you know, and the nice thing, too, is that it's on the first floor right near the lobby. And so it's accessible for everybody to go in of all ages and abilities. You know, we serve, in addition to, you know, most people think of the Y and they think of families and young people, but we serve a fair amount of seniors, a lot of adults with disabilities, and all of our friends from Vista and Sarah who come, and a lot of folks have trouble navigating the stairs to get to the Wellness Center. Now it's going to be you know, right up front. It's going to be great.
Chris, we're excited.
Yeah, we can't wait.
Well, I just want to thank you again for coming back
and pleasure.
Giving
thank
us
you.
The updates, because it's so exciting to know, and it is such a foundation and a gem for our community, which is great.
Well, thank you so much. Pleasure to be here.
Thank you. I want to thank you for joining in, and please give us any feedback or questions at shorethingsct.gmail. Love to hear from you. Till next time, take care.